Good morning, Island City. Before we get started with worship today, I want to read to you Psalm 118, verses 26, 27, and 29. They say, "Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. We bless you from the house of the Lord. The Lord is God, and he has made his light to shine upon us." And in verse 29, "Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his steadfast love endures forever." And that's what we're going to do today. We're going to sing to our God who has saved us, who has loved us, who has sent us his Son, Jesus. Sing with us.
Hope is stirring hearts. Chapter 27, verses 11 through 26. No one really knows exactly when the art of being a puppeteer came into prominent use, but we know that in France was the height of the use of puppets. In fact, people were just amazed at how a skilled puppeteer could make those little Marys, marionettes, dance and move across the stage. And it was just a wonder to behold, and people used to love that art form and see how dances, how music, how dramas could unfold before them by a skilled puppeteer pulling the strings just right. Well, there aren't many marionette shows anymore, but we still use that phrase. When someone pulls strings, they make someone do something, they make something happen in a way that they want it to work out. There were a lot of people who were pulling strings the day Jesus died. Before we look into God's word, let's pause for prayer. Father, we thank you that we can again meet together today, even though we're separated. Lord, we know that what unites us, the blood of Christ Jesus, is more powerful than anything that can separate us. It is more powerful than any virus. It is more powerful than physical distance. We thank you that the blood of Christ Jesus is the power of God into salvation. And Lord, as we look at the day that Jesus died for us, I pray that you would teach us through your word and transform us. And Lord, I pray that as we look at our lives compared to the lives of others who were around that day, that we might make sure that we are recipients of the grace that you offered us through the cross of Christ. It's through him that we pray. Amen. I want to read Matthew chapter 27, beginning in verse 11. Now Jesus stood before the governor, and the governor asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" Jesus said, "You have said so." But when he was accused by the chief priests and elders, he gave no answer. Then Pilate said to him, "Do you not hear how many things they testify against you?" But he gave them no answer, not even a single charge, so that the governor was greatly amazed. Now at the feast, the governor was accustomed to release for the crowd any one prisoner whom they wanted. And they had then a notorious prisoner called Barabbas. So when they had gathered, Pilate said to them, "Whom do you want me to release to you, Barabbas or Jesus, who is called Christ?" For he knew that it was out of envy that they had delivered him up. Besides, while he was sitting on the judgment seat, his wife sent word to him, "Have nothing to do with that righteous man, for I have suffered much because of him today in a dream." Now the chief priests and the elders persuaded the crowd to ask for Barabbas and to destroy Jesus. The governor again said to them, "Which of the two do you want me to release to you?" And they said, "Barabbas." Pilate said to them, "Then what shall I do with Jesus, who is called Christ?" They all said, "Let him be crucified." And he said, "Why? What evil has he done?" But they shouted all the more, "Let him be crucified." So when Pilate saw that he was gaining nothing, but rather that a riot was beginning, he took water and washed his hands before the crowd, saying, "I am innocent of the man's blood. See to it yourselves." And all the people answered, "His blood shall be on us and on our children." And he released for them Barabbas, and having scourged Jesus, delivered him to be crucified. We often think about Jesus' story at the time of his crucifixion, and certainly we should. But in this passage, we're introduced to several other people and several other stories. And the stories that these others have can teach us a great deal. The first story I want us to consider today is the story of the crowd that gathered on the day that Jesus was crucified. The crowd's story is that they were enraged by his claims. Jesus is tried for being king of the Jews. Jesus admitted that he was king of the Jews, but he said, "My kingdom is not of this world." And so for the Romans, that was no reason to crucify him. He wasn't threatening to overthrow the Roman government. He wasn't taking any active steps to overthrowing the Roman government. He says he's a king, but his king's in another world. That's no threat to Rome. That's no reason to find him guilty. That's no reason to crucify him. Then the other accusations that were made by the chief priest and the elders, Jesus didn't answer them. Jesus didn't respond to those accusations, only to what he was being tried for. Roman law required 3 chances to respond before they found someone guilty. Pilate gave Jesus those 3 chances. Over and over again, Jesus didn't respond. And his lack of response amazed Pilate, but Pilate had to admit he found no fault in Jesus. Those who had brought the charges had not proven their charges. There was nothing to find Jesus guilty of. Jesus was an innocent man. Jesus was a righteous man. But everyone in the crowd that day seemed to want him to be crucified. And so to keep the peace, Pilate directly appeals to the crowd. And he says, "What do you want me to do with Jesus then?" This is the crowd that 5 days earlier, many of them had been at a parade on Palm Sunday as Jesus came into Jerusalem. Many of these were probably the same people who had yelled, "Hosanna," not "crucify him." "Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." They had thrown their coats, they had thrown palm branches before him as he'd walked into town, or as he'd come into town on a colt. That same crowd now is enraged by his claims of being king of the Jews. The crowd wants Jesus to be crucified. Pilate says, "I don't find him guilty. I don't think there's anything wrong with him." And the crowd says, "That's fine. His blood will be on us. We'll bear that responsibility, Pilate. We want him crucified." And Jesus is therefore scourged and crucified. Not only do we need to look at the crowd's story, there's a couple individuals who have a story that day. One of those is a man named Barabbas. And Barabbas' story is that he has eluded his crimes. Pilate comes up with a plan. He has a habit of releasing one prisoner to the Jews during Passover. Maybe it's someone who has broken the Roman law, someone who has tried to overthrow the Roman government, someone who has done some kind of a horrible crime. And Pilate, once a year during Passover, to kind of keep the peace, will say, "Well, you can have one guy back." So he says, "Look, I'll give you a choice. You can have Barabbas or you can have Jesus. Who would you like to have back today?" Barabbas was one of those rabble-rousers. Barabbas was a notorious criminal. He was trying to overthrow Rome. He was actively taking steps to see that the Roman government would be overthrown. He may have murdered some Roman guards. He may have murdered Roman citizens. We don't know. He probably stole from folks to finance this operation that he had to try to overthrow the Roman government. He was a criminal. That's one choice. You can have Barabbas back. Or Jesus. Jesus' crime is claiming to be king of the Jews, a king whose kingdom is not of this earth. The elders and the chief priests began to move among the crowd. And they began to encourage the crowd all the more to yell, "They want Barabbas. They want to see Barabbas freed." And that's exactly what happens. Barabbas is released. You can go. There were three crosses on Calvary's Hill that day. One for a common thief. A second for a second common thief. And a third for Barabbas, a notorious criminal, a rabble-rouser. But Barabbas never went to his cross. His cross was taken by Jesus. That cross, that third cross on Calvary's Hill that day, was intended for Barabbas, and Barabbas missed his cross. He missed his cross. He missed his death. He missed his rightful punishment. And there's yet a third story I want us to look at, and that's Pilate's story. Pilate exclaimed his cleanliness. As Pilate was sitting in judgment that day of Jesus, he got a message from his wife. His wife was very upset and sent a messenger to talk to him. And the messenger said that your wife has suffered in a dream. And people took dreams very seriously and often would act in response to a dream. And Pilate's wife had dreamt that Jesus was indeed a righteous man and that Pilate shouldn't have anything to do with Jesus because of his righteousness. Pilate understands that Jesus has done nothing wrong. There's nothing that's worthy of death. He hears that his wife says, hey, I've had a dream. You need to distance yourself from Jesus. And he knows that Jesus really isn't much of a threat. Jesus has no weapons. Jesus has no soldiers. Jesus has no money. Jesus has no social standing. Most importantly, Jesus has no evil. There's no reason to kill Jesus. Pilate understands that Jesus had just been delivered to him for this trial because of envy. The chief priests and the elders just envied the crowds. They envied what Jesus could do. They envied that he taught with one with authority. They envied so much about him that they had brought him to Pilate to crucify him because they hated him so much. So Pilate gives the crowd two opportunities to understand that they're wrong. Who do you want, Barabbas or Jesus? This notorious criminal or this innocent man? Who do you want, he said to the crowd. And they yelled, Barabbas. And so he gave them another opportunity. If I let this notorious criminal go, what do I do with this innocent man? What do I do with Jesus? And they yelled, crucify him. And so Pilate very ceremoniously has water brought out. And he washes his hands in the water, symbolizing, I am clean in this matter. I'm not finding this man guilty. I'm not sending this man to a cross. This has nothing to do with me. I am perfectly innocent and perfectly clean in this matter. And yet, it's Pilate's court. It's Pilate who's put in that position by the Roman government. It's Pilate who has authority. Throughout history, many people have tried to explain that they are clean when they are not. One famous incident of that occurred in 1868 during the presidential election of that year. A man by the name of Seymour was running for the Democrats against Ulysses S. Grant. A reporter for the Nashville newspaper was trying to get freed slaves to vote for the Democratic ticket. He knew that was a difficult thing to do, and so he reasoned with them this way, that if the South had not broken away, they would not be free today. Quoting from his article in 1868, if your state and her sister Southern states had not seceded from the Union, you would not today have been free. If you are indebted to any party or power for your present liberty, you are indebted to the Southern people. In view of these facts, which of the two parties has the greatest claim on you for your support? The Democratic Party. The writer for the Nashville newspaper reasoned that if the South had not seceded and the North had not defeated them, then those slaves would still be held in bondage, but they're free today because of the actions of the South. We wash our hands of 200 years of slavery. We wash our hands of any wrongdoing, of all of the beating, of all of the murder, of all of the slavery. We wash our hands. We're innocent. In a similar way, Pilate, who is ultimately responsible for Jesus that day, for what happens to Jesus, says, well, I don't really want this to happen, so I'm just going to wash my hands of this. It's not my fault. It's not my problem. There's one more story that I want us to look at today. And that's our story. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 24 says, he himself bore our sins in his body on the tree, that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. For by his wounds you have been healed. You see, there was another story that was written that day, and it was our story. whether or not we would receive forgiveness, whether or not our sins would be washed away, was all given opportunity on the cross that day. You see, God has a plan. God has a design for his created universe. And we have all rebelled against that plan. We've all rebelled against God's design for our lives. We've said, God, I want to be in charge. I want to do things my way. That's what sin is. Oh, we have different ways of doing things our way, but it's all sin. And the consequences of sin is death and brokenness. And God doesn't want us to die. So in the fullness of time, he sent Jesus. Jesus was born to die. And Jesus did die on a cross. He was the Son of God. He didn't have to die. He could have called a legion of angels to take him off that cross. He lived a perfect life. As we saw, Pilate even says that he finds no fault. He didn't deserve to die. He didn't have to die, but he willingly died. Because the consequences of rebelling against the source of all life is death, and Jesus took death for us. And if we will repent of our sin, turn from our sin, and believe that Jesus died on a cross for our sin, and allow him to come into our hearts and be the Lord of our lives, the Bible says we will be saved. And we can begin to pursue again God's design for our lives. And it's all possible because of the cross of Jesus. And today, we can choose what our story will be. Will we be enraged by his claims? Will we actively proclaim our separation from him? We don't want to have anything to do with you, Jesus. We don't want to have anything to do with your claims. We don't want to have anything to do with your kingdom. As far as we're concerned, it was fine that you died. You really have nothing for me. I want to be completely separated from you. Maybe we'll choose for our story to be that we exclaim our cleanliness and say, well, Jesus seems fine, seems like a good guy, but I don't really want to have anything to do with him. I'll proclaim my own cleanliness. I'm a good guy. I've done the right thing. I don't really need to bother with Jesus. That really doesn't matter to me. I have nothing to do with that. That's a whole different matter. I'm clean. Or we can elude our crimes. You see, the one who missed their cross broke God's law. The one who missed their cross was properly tried. The one who missed their cross deserved death. The one who missed their cross did nothing to save themselves. The one who missed their cross was replaced by Jesus. The one that missed their cross is you and me and all those who will receive Christ's salvation. So today, what will your answer be? The opportunity to miss your cross is given to everyone. And so today, either you haven't missed your cross and you can decide to miss your cross by asking Jesus to forgive your sin and to become the leader of your life. Or for those of us who have missed our cross, it's an opportunity to rejoice and celebrate because of what Christ has done for us. One of the most poignant monuments I have ever seen is the Vietnam Memorial in Washington, D.C. It is this huge slab of granite that stretches on and on. And on that huge slab of granite are over 58,000 names of people who lost their lives in the Vietnam War. To go and stand at the Vietnam Memorial is an awe-inspiring event. But it must be even more awe-inspiring for three particular men Robert Bedher, Willard Craig, and Daryl Lash. Why for those men? Because those men find their names in the wall. They are able to go up and touch that wall and touch their names. Because due to a data error, their names were listed with the over 58,000 who had died. They can see where they could have died. They can see maybe where they should have died, but know that they escaped death. On that cross could have been written my name. Could have been written your name. But Jesus covered it up. Covered up those names. Covered up the fact that we deserve death. And took death for us. Today, we praise him for his ultimate sacrifice for us.
Begin to breathe out of the- Sometimes people ask why. Why do we do this?
When we came up here, I didn't feel capable. Because I was scared.
Why do we take our families away from places that are familiar and move to places that are far off?
My wife was 9 months pregnant, and we did not know one person who lived in the city.
Why do we come to where there's nothing so we can try and start something?
The Lord really just, He broke my heart for this city before I stepped off the plane.
Why do we stress and strain and struggle and sweat just to make life better for someone else?
There's so many people that are broken, that are lost, and it's heartbreaking.
Yes, sometimes people ask why, and when they do, we tell them. There's places where the truth hasn't yet reached.
We need to share the gospel and reach out our community.
We tell them there's a God who loves them so much, He sent us.
God spoke to us, broke our hearts for the city, and God's call trumps all.
And we tell them there are people who love them so much, they give so that we can go.
When people give to missions, things happen. New believers are getting baptized. New churches are started.
So when people ask why, that's what we tell them. We tell them it's the gospel. It's all about the gospel.
Well, as you can see, it's that time of year to collect for the Annie Armstrong Easter offering for North American missions. All money received that's designated for Annie Armstrong will go to those who are proclaiming the gospel of Jesus Christ all over North America. You can give your offering in the way that we've been giving offerings over the last couple of weeks. You can give online, or you can mail in an offering, or you can drop it by the church. Also, if you've set up on your own bank account the ability to add the church as a payer, then you can make your offering that way. Just be sure to designate anything you want to go to Annie Armstrong specifically for that purpose. This week, we will be doing something a little different. Every day, Zane will be doing a devotion during Holy Week. That will show up on your Facebook feed, and we hope that that uplifts your spirits throughout this week. Also, we will have our regular Wednesday and Thursday night Bible studies for teenagers and adults. If you haven't been able to be a part of those Zoom Bible studies, please contact the church office, and we'll provide information so you can be a part of those. On Good Friday at 3 o'clock, the time when Jesus died, obviously not in this time zone, but when Jesus died, we will have a special brief Good Friday service. It should last about 20 minutes. Please be prepared to take the Lord's Supper as a part of that service. You can bring something that you might use to represent the body of Christ. Maybe it's bread, maybe it's a cracker, whatever works. The same way with something to represent the blood of Christ. Maybe it's purple or red juice or Kool-Aid, but really whatever you have. And we'll take the Lord's Supper together on Good Friday. And finally, we still have the opportunity to fix bicycles. If you would like to have a bicycle or two to work on during this time, please contact me and I will make arrangements for you to get a bicycle to work on. Thank you, and may God bless you throughout this week.